What a delight it was to hear the message of the last hour. A great, great message for all of us. Aren't you glad we have Christian teachers in the school system?
Amen.
Who first of all are educated from God's Word and then have a love and desire to help educate young men and women. What a blessing truly that is. A marvelous lesson. I mentioned yesterday that we would try to kind of begin where I left off, and I left off in the emphasis of the blended home, and as Brother Brian very ably designed the topic, different in the beginning, same in the end. You see, we're talking about the home. God has a design for it. And as the passage found in Psalm 127, verse 1, if the Lord doesn't build a house, they labor in vain that build it. He intended for us to be the same in that design. Sometimes life happens, and sometimes tragedy happens, and sometimes there's interruption. But it doesn't change God's intent and plan. It may be that we have to have surrogate parents along the way, and He designed for us to have that in the church. As was pointed out in one of the messages yesterday, and the young man who grew up in a home, and he was a Christian, his parents weren't, he found parents in the church. For God designed for him to find it. Multiply it 100-fold. Because He intends for that to be the same at the end. That you receive what you need by His design. Either by the immediate parents that He intended for you to have, or by those who are operating in a surrogate manner, provide the very same thing. A knowledge of God, His purpose and plan for your life. That's the way it's always been. Yesterday I left off, and if you look at the manuscript, and we'll go point by point in that, but just to highlight, we left off with the communication part. When we talk about communication, obviously it's important for us to understand what we mean by that. And what I often do in counseling sessions is I hand out a piece of paper with a bold, giant print word on it, communication. And I ask whoever I'm counseling with to, if it's a husband or wife, or it's a family, everybody gets a copy of it, and they have to identify the most two important letters in that word communication. It's always interesting what they choose, and often it's you and I, and typical guesses, which is fine. When they get through, then I box in for each of them in that word communication the letters I see. You can scream, you can lecture, you can do all sorts of things. But if that person doesn't understand what you said, you have not communicated. You verbalize, but you have not communicated. And it doesn't even mean that we always have to agree. But what it does mean is we have to see. And the two most important letters are, I see. So when you talk about communication, there needs to be, first of all, that open communication. It's just like a body of water. You know, if it isn't always being replenished, and if it isn't always dispersing, it can't contain life, like the Dead Sea. It's always receiving, but it never disperses what it received, and so nothing can live there. It's poisonous. The same is true with communication. We have to be replenished, and we have to learn, and we have to gain knowledge. We also have to share that. We have to dispense that. That's communication. We have to all work towards saying, I see. And communication has to be observable for it to be beneficial. We have to see it. How many of us had that light come on when our parents had told us to do things a number of times? And maybe we just couldn't master it, or we just didn't comprehend it. And they'd say, come here, let me show you. And they would pause and take the time and methodically go through each step and say, this is what I'm talking about. Well, they'd already said that, maybe even said it multiple times. But now we observe it. Now we can comprehend it, we can visualize it. Now we can repeat it. So communication needs to be observable. And then it has to be ongoing. It's not just say, well, I told you once and that's it. It has to be ongoing because our life evolves along the way and other responsibilities come in and there are complications that occur and there are interruptions. And so what do we do now? We have basic understanding, but there has to be this ongoing communication. You see, because of being raised by a mother, being from a divorced home, my mother had to be mother and father. And so a lot of things that she communicated with me, because a father should be doing that, along the way, that had to be modified and say, you know, this is a father's role. But since I'm in both roles, I had to do and say those things. You need to understand the difference. That's ongoing communication. Clarify. I memorized early in life Ephesians chapter 6, verse 22. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. My mother made sure I understood that. I memorized that. And she'd make sure for good measure I memorized all the way through verse 4. Father, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. I had no comprehension what that verse was all about until I became a father. Now when you're communicating with a child, it's important that you understand how to communicate with that child. That you not provoke them to wrath. There's a context for it. So communication has to be ongoing. The last part of the last message was to share with us that in this being different in the beginning and same at the end is we're striving to have a legacy that we leave behind, a living legacy so our children can see. Yes, this might have been a complicated situation with a blended family, but we're a family. And we're operating the way God wants us to operate so we can help each other on this journey toward heaven. And with that, there's things that have to be true. We have to have that lordship piece here. We have to understand who's in charge. You see, if the Lord doesn't build a house, we're going to waste our energy and our time trying to do it ourselves. And the Son of God reemphasized that in the end of the Sermon on the Mount when he said, he that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken unto a wise man that builds his house upon a rock. And the rains descend, the floods came, and the winds blow and beat upon the house, and it fell not. For it was founded upon a rock. And when families are founded that way, whether they're the nuclear family, the husband and wife, or whether it's a blended family where there's been unfortunate things happen and two scripturally authorized folks remarry and their children from different marriages, that really doesn't change anything. It's just who is carrying out those responsibilities. It'll be the same in the end. If you're building your house upon the teachings and the principles of the Lord. But he also would make sure we knew that the opposite of that is true. He that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not, I will liken unto a foolish man that builds his house upon the sand. Those same rains are going to come. Those same winds are going to blow. That same experience in life is going to happen. Guess what? It's not going to be the same in the end. That sand is going to be washed away. That home will not stand. And that's what we missed yesterday. I want to use that as an introduction today, and I want to share with you in the short time we have what I do in counseling to make sure that the home is harmonized. And as I mentioned yesterday, as we close, I'm going to take kind of the context of what is brought to me in disharmony and deal with that we use in that process of counseling to bring about harmony. We think about harmony, we usually think about the musical context of harmony, don't we? Where you take this immediate context and these different chords and you make a pleasant sound out of them. If you paid attention last night when we had that period of singing, a number of the song leaders had a pitch pipe. And the reason that is, where do we start this song? So that everybody then will know how to blend their voices together and sing their parts, we have to start somewhere. Where do we start? And so when you think about what we're talking about, the spiritual pitch pipe is going to be God's Word. That's where we start. That's where we stay. If you're ever led singing, and I'm not a song leader, but I'll be singing. because I've been in places where I was song leader, the preacher, the person who waited on the table, and so got to be ready, and so I lead singing. But I don't know a whole lot about music, but my wife does. So sometimes if it's just us in a small mission area, I'll say, pick out some songs we know and sing loud. Because you see, I can kind of pitch off of her, but here's what we've learned. She and I, we always call our children on their birthdays and we sing happy birthday to them. They're like, oh, here's mom and dad again. Sing happy birthday. Well, we're going to do it until we just can't sing. So they just get used to it. That's the way it is. But here's what we've learned. I have to start the song because if she starts it, I don't know how to be harmonious. And that throws her off a little bit. She knows enough about music that that's not it. That's not it. So she lets me start and she knows how to harmonize with me. She blends it right in there and they think I can sing. Because she makes it sound good. That's kind of the way it is when we're talking about harmonizing the home. If you use God's word as a pitch pipe and that's where you start and that makes you make sure that's where you stay, you're going to build a home the way God wants it to be because he designed it that way. I want to share with you what I do in counseling. Being a young preacher, and I told you people taught me how to counsel, I didn't. But the first thing I was faced with in my very first work were two important couples in the church who were going through marital issues. Both of them ended up divorcing. I felt like a complete failure as a minister because I was trying to reason with them and they had all this life experience and I didn't. And I thought, I've got to do something better. I learned it wasn't me. It was their life and their preferences and their decisions, but I needed to do a better job of saying, why is it that we have those problems in the church? And so I started not performing wedding ceremonies until couples would agree to have at least 5 sessions with me. They said, no, we don't have that time. I said, personally, you don't have time to get married. You don't have 5 weeks. But you can take a few minutes with me and let's talk about what you're about to do. And the responsibilities of that. And so I developed some material. Here's process that we go through. You see what couples were bringing to me could be in the umbrella of 3 different issues. They would come to me and say, we just don't communicate anymore. They would do that little acrostic thing and say, tell me what you think communication is. And then we began to say, well, have you ever communicated? Since you say we don't communicate now, have you ever communicated? We process those things. A lot of things are placed under that. The second issue usually was finances. They're arguing about how to spend it. Maybe they don't have enough, they don't think. And so we deal with, it's more than finances. It's always more than finances. You see, when you talk about finances, it's stewardship. And they say, well, we're still spending the same amount of time together. So again, that's stewardship. And so I usually focus upon communication and stewardship. The third thing they bring to me is sexual issues. They're not happy or not satisfied or maybe there have been infidelity. And so in premarital counseling, I make sure we cover all those things. And I have 5 lessons. Here's how I handle it. In the very first lesson, they have to take home. And here's the design of it. I'll tell you a secret. This is live streams of the secrets out now. I can't sneak up on any of the couples that don't know. But here's the secret. It's really short, brief lessons that they have. But they have to have a devotional every single day. Now, they're not married yet, and so they may have to be on the phone, or they may have to, in their visit together, but they have to take 15 minutes a day, the same time every day, and they have to read what I've given them. Not more than 15 minutes. You can take longer than if you want. Can't take less than that. And it can't be, well, 7 o'clock on Monday, and we worked it in somewhere, 5 o'clock on Tuesday. You've got to choose the same time every day. Wherever that is, whenever that is, same time every day. You got to read from that lesson. Choose a paragraph, read the whole lesson, any way you want to do it. But the same time every day, you read what I've given you. And you're going to talk about what you read to each other. We see couples come and say, we don't communicate. Well, I want them to know how to communicate. And the best way to make sure they can communicate is take something they did design, not a message they're trying to communicate, take something they can mutually learn from. So here's the secret. I know because I designed a lesson, I know that God's speaking to them every single day. I know what time of day. Because they told me what time of day they're going to do it. And so I know what God's saying to them. Because I've chosen the verses. And I put them in the lesson. So I know that God is saying to them what he says to me and you about marriage and the creation in Genesis 2. God made Adam and Eve fully knowledgeable of all he wanted them to know. He pre-programmed them to say, this is the information you need. They had it. And so he made sure that that was supposed to take place from this day forward. In Genesis chapter 2, it ends by saying, a man would leave his father and mother, and he would cleave to his wife, and they twain would be one flesh. The intent was that fully loaded information was to be dispensed to those under their care so they could repeat that process. Well, the system has broken down along the way, hasn't it? That I see. I see part been taken out. Communication's not there, so we got to reestablish that. So they're reading every day that information. You see, in the physical creation and in the spiritual creation, we see how God communicates. We see God's intention. And we see deep and abiding intimacy between God and man. And the reason man and woman doesn't have intimacy is because they, first of all, don't have intimacy with God. They really don't feel close to him. They don't understand what he said. They don't understand how he designed things. And so how could they understand each other? That won't get left out. And you look at Genesis chapter 2, and you have that articulated for us. You look at Acts chapter 2, when the spiritual creation, the spiritual family being in place, you have the same process. God told the apostles, you don't worry about what you're going to say. I'm going to give it to you. He fully loaded that information so they had exactly what he wanted folks to know, and he communicated that to them. And those who gladly received the word were baptized. There's that spiritual intimacy being established because they listened to what God said and they became who God wanted them to be. And everything we'll talk about, from communication to stewardship to sexual intimacy, can be learned in those kind of verses. You see, it's important for us to know that. It's important for us to emphasize that, because the stewardship piece that they learn in those lessons, the very first lesson they take home deals with being single, whole, and unique the way God created you. Adam wasn't Eve, and Eve wasn't Adam, but they were both who God wanted them to be. Now, you've got to learn to be that. Who are you? How can God use you? They have to learn that. The second lesson that they take home, and this is a 5-week process, they learn about what it means to give birth to a relationship. When God put Adam and Eve together, they gave birth to a relationship. That was to be duplicated. You see, we want a family. I had this image of a family. You know, my wife's beautiful, so I thought, you know, this is the way we look in the photograph. And wanted a son first, you know, and here's what he'll look like. And here's the relationship we're going to have. And in the photograph, it wasn't any problem at all in my mind. When we got here, wow. He cried half the night. He sold himself. It just wasn't the photograph. I mean, there was interaction, there was responsibility, there were things we had to do. And sometimes when couples come to me, it's not like they dreamed it up. It's not that photograph. And now there's this interaction. And you know what happens in relationships? They cry sometimes. They need things. And the only way they know how to express that is to say, I need something here. Sometimes relationships solve themselves, don't they? You see, when they say finances, we have a financial problem. It usually means stewardship. What are you doing with your time? And what are you doing with what God gave you? And in that Sermon on the Mount, the Lord described that, first of all, having the priorities right, lay yourselves up, treasures in heaven. But you also manage what I gave you here. The birds do that. The lilies of the field do that. Take that which I've given you and use it the way I intended. Manage it, be a good steward of it. He told the first couple that. He had this beautiful garden. He said, now, tend and keep it. Not complicated. Just do like I told you to do. Take what I've given you and take care of it. In a relationship, God's given us that context. Take care of it. If you manage your time and the blessings of God right, you'll get where you need to be. You can't go in those relationships and want everything that your parents had. Just not possible for you to have it. In 6 weeks, when it took them 30 years to accumulate those. Understand that. So you see, if they're reading this every day, they're paying attention to what they're reading. They're talking about what they're reading. It's not the husband telling the wife what to do, or the wife insulting the husband what he didn't do. It's God saying, this is what I expect you to do. Now they've got to talk about what God said. It's kind of different, isn't it, when you're communicating God's message. Here's the third piece of that. In that devotional, every day, same time every day, after they've read this together and talked about what they've read, they have to talk to God about it. Ask God to help them be who He wants them to be, whatever it is that they're studying on that day. Kind of hard to argue about that, isn't it? See, I know none of them came up with it because I wrote the material. I inserted the verses. God's already given the message. I'm just saying, pay attention to what He said. And they're talking about it every day. The third issue that they bring to me is sexual issues. You either feel deprived or maybe things have happened in the past that they never resolved, and now there's complications in their intimacy. I give them different opportunities in their reading. I'll give them, let me give you another secret. Again, live stream secrets out. I'll never be able to say people don't know. When I taught the Memphis School of Preaching, I had the good pleasure of sharing this material with the preachers. I always say, got anything we can use in premarital counseling? And so I'd share these five lessons with them. Some of them would sneak around thinking that none of their other classmates would know, and it all turned out that they all came by my office individually and said, this is really good stuff on premarital counseling. You have anything on marital counseling that I can use? And I said, sure did. I said, go right here on my computer, and I'd take that material and I'd change the title at the top from premarital to marital. That's the way it works. You see, if they're having a problem, they didn't get this right. Now, I don't insult them by saying, well, this is kind of premarital counseling, and I know this is marital counseling, just take that. I'm shrewd enough to take that out of the caption. But God still said what He said about that. God still intended. It's going to be the same in the end. If you follow His design, it's going to be the same in the end. And so I make sure that they focus on those things. And the cause of the world in the last lesson did a great job of explaining how the world has perverted things. And several of those young people, it's all about sex and world definition of sex. It's so degraded from what God intended for it to be. Amen. No wonder people are disappointed when they go looking for it and it's not there. You can't even buy dog food without some sexual overtone being used to advertise it. I just want dog food. You don't have to put a model on there. You don't have to give some subtle insinuation that your whole sexual life is going to be improved if you buy this dog food. I just need dog food. I need to feed my dog. It ought to be as simple as that. But you just see how perverted our life is. And so I make sure young couples kind of clear their minds and just look at the beauty as God designed it. You see, Adam and Eve had this close, pure, intimate relationship with God. So they had all the ingredients, the base, to be close and intimate with each other. It was all there. It was only when the perversion took place and selfishness entered to say, well, maybe I could have more, or maybe this is about me. Then it became complicated, didn't it? It complicated their intimate relationship with God, and it complicated their relationship with each other. So I want these young couples to be able to clear their minds and go back and look and harmonize using God's instruction as that pitch pipe to say, this is what He intended. You see, don't have time to look at it in detail, but I give them particularly if they're married couples, I encourage them, and maybe I'd rather have it written much on this. Sometimes you have to go outside the church to get material that's addressed to it. But there's a book by Gary Chapman called Love Languages. And it mentions the fact that because of our upbringing, we have kind of different dialects and how we see things, and he has prioritized certain things about communication. But that's also used in the intimate relationship. You don't realize that person's language, you don't learn how to speak it, somebody is not going to be satisfied. What I often learn is that women aren't satisfied in marriages because men have believed the commercials and they think that's all marriage is. That is an important part of marriage, but that's not marriage. That's not the definition of marriage. That's one of the benefits and pleasures of marriage, but it was to be mutually enjoyed. God made both Adam and Eve. He designed them that way. He designed them both to have pleasure in that most intimate relationship. Here's what happens to us. Both in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy chapter 24, and the New Testament, in 1 Peter chapter 3, God intended for us to have knowledge about each other. The Old Testament men were relieved from going to war and those outside things. They didn't have a vacation, but they had to concentrate on saying, if you're going to have a family, then learn how to have a family, and you stay home that year, and you get to know your wife, so that you can cheer her up. It sounds like there's a learning process going to take place. There's a mutually sharing in that intimacy, so that you can have a harmonized home like God designed it. Peter puts it this way, that husbands are to dwell with their wives according to knowledge. You see, when they come to me with problems, they say, I just don't understand it. We just can't communicate. And my answer is, well, you have to. You do. And so I give them useful tools, and we make a commitment for 5 weeks that that's how we're going to handle it. We're going to address things this way. And I use God's word as that pitch pipe to make that harmonious relationship what he intended. Sometimes when they apply it real well, they just think, I'm the most wonderful person who's ever lived. And they'll see me years later and say, oh, Brother Mark, you just made this. I said, I didn't make a difference. God made the difference. And you made the application. It's important for us to understand that, for us not to lose sight of that, and for us to appreciate that. In that final week, I give those young couples who are contemplating marriage, I give them Tim LaHaye's book. He's not a member of the Lord's Church, but very well written. His wife's a nurse, and they deal with the act of marriage, the intimate part of marriage. You see, in the church, we do a pretty fair job of telling them what not to do. We get that across in Bible class and from our sermon. But I'm here to tell you, we do a lousy job with the how-to. And that most important part of their relationship, they are absolutely clueless. And Satan advertised the other day, every day, all these lies with dog food and everything else. And we just kind of quiet about it. Shh, talk about that. Why shouldn't we talk about it? God designed it. The one place where it ought to be talked about in my context is among God's people. That's why I let them read from God's word and say, he intended for that to be beautiful and enjoyable. You save yourself for that relationship, but know what you're doing when you get there. And in that Tim LaHaye book, they're able to gain information. You see, communication is information, contemplation, observation, and confirmation. That's what communication is all about. And when we're talking about harmonizing, you have to have all those components. I've had the good pleasure of being able to teach not only the Memphis School of Preaching students, but every other year I go to Bear Valley and I teach biblical counseling. We deal with some of these things. And I try to share this material with those young preachers. So, number one, so I tell them, use it in your own home. Don't be handing this out if you haven't tried it. You sit down with your wife, you study this material the same time every day. See if you can do it. If you can't do it, don't ask other folks to do it. Make sure you can do it. Enhance your own marriage and share it with others. I left the Mexico to preach and to go to Anchorage University for the specific purpose of training Christian counselors. Satan is kicking us. He is brutalizing us with his lies and perversions. And homes are disintegrating everywhere. And we don't know what to do about it. You see, in the psychological world, it's a dark, humanistic cloud over it. The people who ought to really understand psychology and ought to be equipping themselves to counsel people in the right way are Christians. Because we know who God is. We know he created us psychological beings, reasoning beings, sexual beings. But he harmonizes that according to his will. And when we blow that pitch right, we blend our lives to that. There is a harmonizing of the home that's beautiful, has everything God intended for it to have. Let's encourage our young people to gain that kind of knowledge. Let's encourage those in our communities and maybe congregations in a particular area and go together and maybe even help pay for the education of someone in your area who's willing to be a Christian counselor. So that Satan no longer owns the turf. You know, have you ever had that opportunity where you needed to call a counselor and didn't know what to do? And anybody even recommend it's tough to do it? What do you think about it? Put forth some effort and say, here's what we're going to do about it. I hope these things have been helpful to you. This is not what Brother Davis has in his tent. He has some great stuff in there. But this is what I deal with every day. This is how I deal with it. And I think that brings about a harmonizing in the home because God designed the home. And those who strive to build a house without God will labor in vain and do it.